All right, now, as you can see, I have the Swift 2 camera mounted onto a little quadcopter here that I use to test cameras pretty often. You've probably seen it in some of the past videos recently. A couple of points to note, I'm only using the three-pin cable, which is power, ground, and video, out to this camera switch, which I use to switch when I use more than one camera at once. And then the video just passes through the switch to the video transmitter here. I don't have an audio input on this particular transmitter, so I'm not going to be using audio right now. We'll test it at a later date, but not right now. And because I'm not using the VBAT wire input, it's going to read the voltage on the power lead, which is 3S, you know, just coming straight out. So I got 3S power coming out of the connector here in the quad and just goes into the switch and powers the transmitter and the camera. So, if you wanted to use the VBAT sensor to read an external voltage, just say if you were powering this off of 5 volts, for example, then you would run that VBAT connector straight to the battery. But because we're powering the camera off of the flat battery, it's easier to just run the 3-wire connector, so you have that option. And as you can see, I have my OSD control cable plugged into the back of the camera right now, because we're gonna go through some of the settings and show you how to configure the OSD and stuff like that before we fly it. So we're gonna switch over to that now. All right, now we're looking at the live video feed from the quadcopter with the Runcam Swift 2 mounted on it. If you press the joystick, center press, just one click press, it's gonna bring up your OSD menu that is the same for all the basic Swift, the standard Swift, and all your basic 600 TV line Sony cameras. So we're not going to go through that. There's plenty of videos already covering this. I'll link to one I did a good while back that should be relevant to all of these settings. But the Runcam cameras, the stock settings out of the box, they're pretty much good to go. So you shouldn't need to bother with that. But if you do, you can go through that and kind of get an idea of what they do. We're going to exit that menu for now. And the important part, the part we're most interested about, is the OSD. You can see in the lower left corner we're showing 10.6 volts right now, and your pilot name, which is by default set to Runcam in the center of the screen, and on the right corner is a timer. It starts when you apply power to the camera. Currently been powered up for 3 minutes and 11 seconds. Now on the joystick, if you hold down, you can move this around anywhere on the screen, pretty much left, right, up and down. Put it where you want it. Center click to exit that. Hold left. It's going to do the same with the voltage. You can move it where you want it. Center click to exit. Hold right. We'll do the same thing for the timer. Allow you to place it where you want it on the screen. Center click to exit and press up and hold should bring up your OSD configuration menu. Now you can see at the top you have these letters and numbers to set your pilot name. We're going to leave that on default Runcam for now. And you can see on your, you have your pilot, timer, and voltage and baseline, which you can turn on and off. We're going to leave the pilot on, timer off, voltage on. I'm sorry, timer on. By default, baseline is turned off. I wasn't sure what that was. You have off and 1 through 9 for your settings. Default is off. We're going to change that to 1 and exit the menu. And you see this row of dotted lines at the top center of the screen. That is what they call the baseline. And that is position 1. So if you hold up on the joystick to get back into the menu and run back down to baseline, let's set it for roughly in the middle. It should be 5, position 5. It's going to put it pretty close to the center of the screen. And if we do the same, go back down and run it all the way up to position 9, it's going to be the lowest position. You can see it's right down toward the bottom. And I'm guessing that's supposed to be like a reference to your horizon when your quadcopter airplane is level or whatever. I personally don't see much use for it. And I agree with their decision to have it turned off by default. So I'm going to leave that turned off. And then just to demonstrate one of the other settings, we'll turn the pilot off as well. Pilot name, exit, and you can see the name in the center of the screen as well as the baseline is now gone because we've turned those off. But for the rest of this review, I'm going to leave. Something's going on here. I just ignore that beep and my battery is low. Or actually, that may be. No, it's a low battery warning. We're going to turn that off in just a minute. We're going to turn the pilot name back on and leave the baseline off, or we're going to exit the menu. So that's it. That's all your settings for the OSD menu. And
all right, now as you can see, my ground station is set up right over here. I'm going to be flying, watching this monitor here, and recording on my computer, which you can see here, which is through this mini HD camera by FireWire. And we have a quad outside, right out here. Video receivers are there. And I want you to notice it's a pretty overcast, kind of foggy, misty day. It's not the best conditions for flying, but it's what we have to work with. So we're gonna do our best and see how it works out. I've actually just finished flying the quad, and right after I took off, I had trouble with the my little DVR, mini DV camera locked up during the recording. So I stopped recording with the computer and the camera, and I started using my old FPV Japan recorder, which you can see here. So I just want to make a quick note of that. The flying footage that you will see is from the FPV Japan recorder and not from the Sony mini DV camera. But other than that, let's get to the footage now.
All right, now one thing I noticed with the this 2.5 millimeter lens, I really like a field of view. You have a pretty decent wide angle field of view and not a lot of fisheye distortion as you get with like the older 2.1. And I would really like to see how the 2.3 and the 2.1 millimeter lens, these new lenses from Runcam, compare. But as far as the 2.5, I really like it. With the IR block sensor lens combo, I'm not sure where the filter's at. It's either on the sensor or the lens, but with the IR filter in the camera, the colors are really accurate and pretty vibrant without being washed out like you typically get during daylight with an IR sensitive camera. I really do like the colors on this one though, and like I said, I really like the field of view on the lens, and it's also quite sharp and detailed across the full frame from corner to corner, so there's no soft spots on the corners or the center like you do get with some of the wider field of view, the older 2.1 millimeter lenses. I'm pretty impressed with the image quality. It's about what I expected. The lens is really nice. I like the lens. As far as light handling and everything with the camera, it's the same as all the other 600 line Sony imagers, like the standard Swift and all the older variants. As far as the OSD itself, you can see at the bottom, you have the timer and the name and the voltage. You know, I left all that on defaults. You saw earlier in the video, you can turn any of those on or off as you need and move them around the position where you want on the screen. I did check the voltage sensor, the accuracy against my voltmeter, and the OSD on the Swift 2 was reading about 0.1 volt lower than my multimeter. So when just say, for example, I was reading 11.5 on the OSD, my multimeter was showing 11.6 in the battery pack at the same time. So there is a note in the manual that because of the voltage regulator and surge protection in the camera, it's going to read a little bit lower if you're using the camera power to display on the OSD. But if you use the VBAT sensor wire, the blue wire in the wiring harness, it's not going to read lower like that. It should be a little bit more accurate. But personally, if anything, I prefer it to read a little bit low on the OSD. So you have that little bit of buffer, you know, that little bit of reserve. So you don't, you know, if it's reading high, you might say try to run your battery all the way down and your pack is actually lower than what your OSD is reading.
And I've had OSDs that were miscalibrated like that in the past, and I've actually ruined batteries flying them too low trying to get the last little bit. And you know, if you're cutting it short trying to make it back home on your last little bit of battery, you might actually have to land short of your field and not make it back home. So if anything, I would like the OSD to read a little bit lower, and in this case it does read just a hair lower, so that's a good thing. It's quite accurate, and you know, it's never going to be perfect, so it's on the side of caution, so I like that. The timer, the only thing with this timer, it starts counting up as soon as you apply power to the camera. So when you power your quad up, and it might sit around for a minute or two waiting to get GPS lock and everything before you actually take off and start flying, you need to take note of that. If you are relying on a timer to know when to land, you know, you need to account for that little bit of extra time you have powered up sitting on the ground before you actually take off. But I always like to watch, you know, voltage first. And so, I mean, you just keep an eye on your voltage. You know when your battery's getting low. The timer is a nice reference, but if you don't need it, you can always turn it off. I'm going to leave it on this one. So, as you can see on the screen here, the video recorded. Image quality is quite nice. I don't really have any complaints. I think Runcam have done a great job of integrating the OSD into what was already one of, as far as I'm concerned, the best FPV cameras on the market, that being the Swift, of course, the standard Swift. And you can still use this camera in place of a standard Swift. The stand, you know, the regular 3-pin cables plug right into it, and in fact that's what I'm using on here. You saw that in the first part of the video. If you use it in conjunction with another OSD in your airplane or quad or whatever, and you prefer not to use the integrated OSD, you can always turn all of those options off and you have a basic Swift without the OSD, and you do still get the integrated audio if you choose to use it. Unfortunately, this quad is not set up for audio, so I'm not able to test it now. I will probably get to that at a later date. I'll mount this camera into something else and check the audio out, see how it works. One thing on the topic of audio, as far as onboard audio on quads or fixed wing or anything, I've basically given up on high quality audio from the FPV feed quite a while back. You're never going to get, you know, useful quality audio other than if you have an onboard voltage beeper or something and no other way to monitor your voltage. I've used microphones for that in the past, but once again, you have a voltage monitor, an OSD built in right into your camera here. So again, you wouldn't need the microphone for that. About the only really useful thing I can think of that you want audio on your airplane for is sometimes if your ESC has an issue, the low voltage cutoff kicks in, and you're cruising along half throttle, whatever, on the throttle stick, and your motor shuts off, then you might not know it until your airplane bleeds off airspeed and stalls. But you can actually hear that if you have a microphone on board. As far as quads, if you lose a motor, of course you're going to know it immediately. So once again, still not very useful. I wouldn't put too much merit into the microphone sound quality, but we will get to it and test it at a later date. But as for now, the Runcam Swift 2 gets my approval. I give it a thumbs up. I don't personally see anything to complain about. I recommend it. It's definitely going to go on my list of preferred cameras, especially for closer range setups where I might not have an OSD already. You know, pretty much everything I fly now has OSDs built into it, except this particular quad that I'm using to check it now, so it's a perfect match here. But back when I was starting out with some fixed wing flying, I really could have used a camera like this back when I was flying Easy Stars and stuff like that, slow sticks and all that stuff, and had no OSD or other way to monitor my voltage. This would have been very handy. So I recommend it, and hopefully this video shows you what you wanted to know. And
anything in particular you would like to see, just drop a note in the comments below. And I hope this is helpful. If you liked it, give me a thumbs up. If you didn't, let me know why. You know, all that usual good stuff. And subscribe if you want to get a notice when I upload videos in the future. And I guess that's the end of this video now. So thanks for watching.